Hello and welcome to the Eastern Kicks podcast, a regular magazine program about East Asian film led by me, Andrew Heskins, founder and grandmaster of easternKicks.com, and James Mudge, our leading writer.
Hey, up.
Each episode, we'll be taking a look at the latest films, news, and festivals, often chatting to filmmakers and stars along the way. Welcome to the latest episode. This time, we're paying tribute to the great pop musician, electronic music innovator, and film composer, Ryuichi Sakamoto, who died from cancer on the 28th of March this year at the age of 71. As an 80s documentary about him, Tokyo Melody, resurfaced in a new restored version at New York's Japan Society's Japan Cuts 2023. There's a lot of letters in that one. Author and film lecturer Colette Balmain, self-confessed Sakamoto uber fan, joins us to talk about the film. Thank you for joining us.
Pleasure.
Meanwhile, our very own Yonah Sichrovsky spoke to the film's director, Elizabeth Lennard, and later on, the king of audio commentaries, Frank Djeng, will share his thoughts on the great man as well. But first, it's the most important question of the day. What are you drinking? As our guest, Colette, what have you got for yourself?
Well, I've got some Taiwanese lemon lager. It's low alcohol. Very nice.
Very interesting. What about you, James?
Oriental spiced gin, which has got pictures of God. I mean, Jesus, there's a lot of things on there which don't look like they go together, including coriander, cumin seeds. A lot of different things on the bottle. It's a Whitley Neal one. It was on special offer.
There might be a reason why it's on the special offer.
Yes, there is. It's not that great. But it's 43%. I don't take tonic or soda with my gin. I just drink it straight. So yeah. It's okay.
I think I slightly ruined the theme because this isn't exactly Asian flavoured or anything. It's from the Colonel Brewery. Export Stout, London 1890. And that's doesn't beat your percentage, James. It's 7.4.
Pretty healthy.
Very healthy, though. You know, and it's the warmest day for quite a few weeks now, so of course I'm drinking stout because that's how I roll.
Well, you know, I'd like to have a nice brandy on a warm summer's day if we ever get one in Scotland.
So let's start by talking about the film Tokyo Melody. It screened as part of a tribute to Sakamoto as part of the Japan Cuts film in festival in New York, which ran from the 26th of July to the 6th of August. It was released in 1985 originally. It's kind of quite an interesting documentary because it's unlike what you kind of get nowadays. It's not very linear. It's much more playful, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's very arch in the way that it kind of approaches its subject. So you've got deliberately got Sakamoto wandering around with this, some of his videos and concert footage kind of behind him. There's a great bit where he's at one stage that he's on the he's showing off a lot of technology that wasn't really open to everyone. But he's being driven around. He's got a car phone. He picks up the phone. Mushy mushy. Ah yes, yeah. You know they say that Debussy liked images as much as he liked music. Bye. There's a lot of quite arch stuff like that. I mean, what did you make of the documentary, Colette?
I mean, I kind of think it's interesting. I watched Coda, which is the kind of second documentary. I think it's a lot later. It's 2017.
Yeah. Yes.
And Coda is very, very different to this one. I felt that with Tokyo Melody, I didn't really learn that much about Sakamoto. Yeah. I learned about Japan in that time period. And so I found that the scenes outside, which had like, you know, Japanese Elvises and, dancing to Michael Jackson, I thought that was all really interesting. So for me, it's a snapshot of the musical scene. Mm. I think you didn't really, really get to know Sakamoto. But it's very short. And I think the aim of the documentary wasn't really to do that kind of introduction of a person, but was more about capturing Sakamoto as perhaps the essence of that particular period of time. So he represents that particular, you know, movement in music and experimentation.
Mm.
And I think it's really interesting because he kind of says at the quite early on that he's interested in technology, and he sees Japan as, you know, the most highly technological society, and we have lots of shots of that.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't comment on the politics of any of that.
No.
So it's interesting in a way that it's very apolitical, which Coda isn't. So Coda's very different. I think the other thing was it also is that image of kind of Sakamoto and David Bowie, who were both representative of a certain period. And you have a Sakamoto talking about like gender and he's in kind of makeup that I always associate with Bowie from that particular period.
It's very new wave as well, that kind of period. I mean, as far as what we see of Sakamoto, it feels very managed by him. Seems like there's lots of almost kind of music video skits that he's doing and presenting himself as. You know, so you've got these bits where he's there and sometimes doing some very strange things. We do get these snapshots, and it's interesting to see, and I think we can come onto this a bit later, but it's interesting to see that connection between Coda, where he is constantly recording bits of sound and how to use them, and the technology he's using then, which is, you know, mainly the Fairlight synthesizer, which is, you know, a very basic, in modern day terms, much more basic than your mobile phone, a computer with great big floppy disks for each sound sample. But I mean, at that point is really a game changer in terms of the sounds that you can make. I found quite fascinating is that it is interesting to hear how he's talking about music and how it's changing. And maybe it's not quite, I mean, there's some prophecy in how he's talking about stuff, and because he's in this very unfortunate position of seeing and having access to this technology of seeing what's happening to music, he kind of expresses this idea of, I think what he's kind of talking about is music being absolutely everywhere, and part of that is the sort of technology of the time that we're talking about, the Walkmans, which do become revolutionary because you're not listening to a transistor radio, you're listening to your own music, you know, and eventually that becomes the iPod and your iPhone and other brands exist. But, you know, that this is not a radio, this is not a turntable, but this music is absolutely... So he did seem to be kind of voicing these different ideas and actually really quite... actually kind of, in some ways, although he might not kind of get where it actually ends up going, he is kind of well ahead of the zeitgeist in what's happening to music. I think that was the thing I found most fascinating in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I agree. I didn't see it before. This was the first time I'd watched it, and it's much more of a collage. I think maybe that's the word, or a scrapbook. I don't know. It didn't feel like a documentary in that kind of sense. And I completely agree with what Colette says. You don't really. I was surprised at how little it actually seemed to explore. You know, tell you about him, and it, you know, it's not in any sense like a biopic type of documentary. It's more. It's a lot more. Conceptual. Maybe is the right word, and then I found it mainly interesting as like a timestamp or a time capsule, just seeing a lot of the stuff in there, which I've like seeing the floppy disks and everything like that. It's really interesting to see, especially since it is only just over what's an hour long, give or take. But some of the footage which is in there, it seems a little bit random, and I agree with what you said with. They're like little skits or vignettes and everything all the way through it. So it's an interesting one. It's not what I expected it to be, put it that way.
Yeah, yeah.
But I wonder, you know, that's kind of captured, isn't it, in the title of Tokyo Melody. So it doesn't really start with Sakamoto.
True. Yeah.
So it's really that he's part of this Tokyo Melody. And so it kind of situates him, I think, in what's happening in Japan at the time. And I think that's really kind of, a lot of the time it gets forgotten how kind of revolutionary music was in Japan. You know, that tends to get, I think, it tends to get edited out of a lot of things, that people don't think about Japan and kind of the experiments that were going on there. And, you know, Sakamoto's work with, like, music, global music, is as well very revolutionary. So, and so you get a snapshot of Japanese society in which certain things would be problematic these days in terms of you know, some of the kind of almost blackface, if you like, in the scenes outside. But place ourselves within context, but also you get this idea of Japan as this place of music and musical evolution, of musical experimentation, and as a place where it's happening. So for me, that's what I kind of take away from that is, and I've never, you know, even though I've kind of written about Japanese cinema, I've never seen that kind of snapshot of Japan at that particular time. So for me, thinking of it, you know, in terms of like some of the experimental cinema that was going on in Japan, it kind of does connect up with that in really interesting ways.
I think it is just to kind of see the way people were and the way we're thinking, and so that some of those kind of, you know, those exterior shots are so, you know, they are absolutely genuine. And it just kind of puts more of a context on that sort of thing. I mean, the other thing that is that they feature the song in there quite heavily. And it would be interesting, I mean, we can talk a bit about more of this when we kind of talk about his legacy, but, you know, that it features a song, Behind the Mask, which was almost on the Thriller album.
So
it was like, you know, like an album, you pick 9 or 10 tracks, it just missed being on there, and it would have been just slightly, I think basically kind of added a few lyrics to it, and they didn't really change the music. So it was one of these kind of, I mean, it's just one of the kind of key Yellow Magic Orchestra tracks that with a kind of disco melody and whatever. And so, yeah, so it was almost on there, almost. Michael Jackson recorded it, didn't get used. In the end, one of the key session keyboard players on the Thriller album, Greg Billingains, released it as a single. Then Eric Clapton did a cover version. I think it was a top 10 hit in the UK. Pretty bad version of it. Then Ryuichi Sakamoto re-records the track as himself, with a guy called Bernard Fowler doing the vocals. Eventually, the Michael Jackson version came out, well, posthumously, and it's really terrible, because they just play up to all the kind of worst sides of the old Michael Jackson set. But it's almost kind of interesting to know what would have happened had that song actually been on the Thriller album. I mean, it's kind of, and it kind of says a lot about his music, because kind of being able to talk about music in a very technical fashion, but to me, I think there's a real mix between East and West with everything he does. I feel like he's the melodies feel quite Asian, and it's right from the kind of earliest kind of stuff, and the Yellow Magic Orchestra songs, when they're particularly going, they're going to do the very disco stuff. But under that, underpinning everything, and it goes right through his soundtracks as well, you've got these very warm, comforting chords that are actually kind of drawing a lot more on kind of R&B and soul, R&B and soul kind of sound to them. That they're very, very kind of grounding to them. And he's a kind of really interesting juncture of both of those kind of sounds, and it is neither, and it is both. And I think that's one of the kind of, and it is very distinctive. I think you do hear him, you know it's him, in the same way that most of the time you'd recognise Ennio Morricone, or you'd recognise John Carpenter, or you'd recognise, you know.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the things, and it was interesting to see this in terms of Japan, because I see it a lot in terms of Korean music and K-pop music, is that Michael Jackson is very much seen as this, I don't know, this kind of role model in Korea. Like, Michael Jackson is the kind of epitome, if you like, of I think someone who, you know, was an artist that sang and that danced. And so, you know, Michael Jackson's kind of influence is really, because a lot of people that kind of talk about, you know, oh, the kind of connection between like K-pop and rap music, but actually the connection goes back much further.
Mm.
You know, Michael Jackson is the figure that, you know, when you see some of these kind of idols starting out, is they're kind of copying his moves. So I think it's really interesting to think of Michael Jackson within that Asian context, and just how influential his music's been in developing other musics.
Shall we have a listen to Yonah's chat with the director, Elizabeth Lennard, now?
I've heard JapanCon's actually refers to your film as rare, right?
Well, there hasn't been really a public showing, you know. Rare, yes, rare, definitely rare. I mean, it has been rare, but now we're trying to release it. You know, it was shown in 1985 when I made it, and 86, 87, maybe even. It was shown in film festivals all over the world, but it was never distributed for various reasons at the time. And then it sort of lay dormant. I mean, it had some kind of release in Japan. I mean, it was shown on, I actually was on DVD in Japan for a while.
Okay.
But all of that disappeared. And then, what can I say? It was never released or re-released. And then at some point, somebody put it on YouTube where maybe you saw it, or did somebody send you a link? Or I don't know. Have you seen the film?
Yeah, so they have a link on Vimeo. I assume that was yours.
I don't really know anymore where, and I don't really know how they got the link on Vimeo, but at one point somebody hacked it and put it on YouTube from some other country, because actually in France, they do protect authors, directors' rights to a certain extent, you know, if it's in France. It's a complicated, but it was, I guess, what you could call now hacked and put on YouTube quite some time ago. And at some point I tried to figure out where it was coming from, but I couldn't figure out. Now somebody who knows said it was coming from Australia.
But then how did JapanCuts get it this time?
Yeah, because they knew about, so this is what I learned. Okay, so years go by, and then I learned that it's become a kind of cult film, that there were 400,000 views, that many people saw it on YouTube and so forth. And so they obviously had heard of it. And so the person who does the film programming at JapanCuts, Alexander Fee, contacted me. And, you know, I did, he's a former projectionist, he told me. And he was eager to show the 16mm print. So I actually have a 16mm print in my basement, and he helped me find somebody here in France, in Paris, who could check the print to see if it was screenable. So we did that, and you know, it did. I mean, it had a history, that particular print, but we sent it to Alexander Fee in New York, and you know, he reinforced the splices, so hopefully the film won't break during the screening. What can I say? I don't know how much film you've actually seen, because you're young.
Oh yeah, well, I'm nerdy enough to make the distinction. I still prefer film. And now the new Nolan film, Oppenheimer, that's making a big deal about being 70mm. So some young people still get into it, I think. But it's what's cool about it is that it came out of your, it was just sitting in your basement, and now this is one of the features of this year's festival. I mean, when I saw it, I felt lucky. Did you get to see it with a crowd yet?
No.
I think when you're with them, you'll realize that this is something really special. Now that when people get to see it, it's so intimate, it's so revealing, and it's like right at the perfect time.
I don't hear your voice.
Okay. It's also right at the perfect time in kind of Sakamoto's development, don't you think?
Yeah, this is what, you know, I realized that, you know, when we made it, it was the beginning of his sort of solo. It was his first solo album. I mean, I think it was his first solo album, and he had, you know, YMO had split up and he was going his own way. And there were very good elements that came together to make this film. And so it was very, you know, there was a lot of luck involved. And so what can I say? I realize now, you know, because I've been, I didn't follow all of Ryuichi Sakamoto's career because he had a huge career. And since his sad, you know, passing, I've been contacted by different people from different kind of art magazines and so forth. So I didn't follow the extent of his career. And obviously I went to see the films that he scored, you know, some of them, of course, the Bertolucci films. And, you know, I followed his career as a film composer, but his career, and I saw him play a few times in Paris afterwards. But I didn't follow his whole huge career. So,
yeah, and it's probably interesting because now everyone's treating you like the expert, probably, you know? And you have to kind of speak to his life. But I mean, it's kind of similar for me. I mean, I'm watching this as one of the centerpieces of the festival, but I wasn't familiar with him either and what he became, but I should be. Now that I'm looking, I really should be. I think he has over 60 soundtrack credits, and he did this beautiful work with Fukushima as well, I believe. So I really feel like there's a reason that this documentary also should be coming back to light. And you open it with a quote saying something to that effect, being like, Debussy was for a future generation. In a way, wouldn't you agree Sakamoto and Tokyo Melody are kind of also very apt for this future generation?
You know, it's interesting because the things that he said to me, because there's not that much talking in the film, but the few things he said, I noticed that he did repeat them in other, you know, forms or quotes, because that's what he thought. You know, he really was influenced by Debussy. And also, I mean, I'll be very honest, when he said that to me, you know, because I was funded by French experimental TV, I thought maybe somewhere in the back of my mind, I thought he also wanted to say something to the French. Do you know what I mean? But I mean, that did occur to me, not to say anything bad about Debussy, because I love Debussy, but obviously that he really was an influence, Debussy, on him. And the thing that I sort of discovered and understood more recently is how, I mean, his compositions to do with nonlinear music, and that's what he sort of began. And his whole idea or concept of nonlinear music without a beginning, without an end, is something that really spoke to me. Because I came from a generation of, I don't know if you've heard of Marshall McLuhan.
And so I'm a huge fan.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
But anyway, so yeah. I was brought up, you know, weaned on Marshall McLuhan, nonlinear. And so without having to discuss that with Ryuichi Sakamoto, it seemed to be something that I totally understood or felt, you know, it spoke to me. And I could say that probably when I made the film in the beginning, there might be some people who, because it wasn't a really classical documentary, didn't get that. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't in
I read your interview, I think you did several days ago, and you mentioned McLuhan, and I was hoping you'd bring it up again, because I think it's hard to get, to be honest. But as soon as you see your documentary, I instantly thought, oh, French New Wave, but there's more going on. There's a lot of theory Would you say that there was a kind of a theory in the approach as well as kind of what came out of it?
You know, I'm a visual person because I'm also an art photographer. I can say that I've been showing since I was very young. I went to art school before going to film school. And so I've always had kind of two careers. So, and I left UCLA film school because it was too linear. You know, my screenwriting classes, they were teaching you a kind of formula. And I know the screenwriters are on strike, but they were teaching you a formula. I'm talking about the 70s. And it was not something that spoke to me because that's not what I wanted to do. So it was, you know, making the film, you know, the idea behind the film is what the film is. In other words, it's a portrait of Ryuichi Sakamoto with the and a portrait of Tokyo sounds, through the sounds of Tokyo. So that's what it was, you know, on paper. And that's what it is.
And is this something you came into knowing you were going to do, or did it kind of, as you saw Ryuichi, as you heard him, and as you saw what was behind him, did it all kind of come together?
You know, again, films are documentary film. I mean, it's a long subject, but I was very lucky to have, it was the experimental part of French TV called INA, l'Institut National de l'Audiovisuel. And somehow they are not a broadcaster. They were never a broadcaster. So they had to find funding from the TV channels, the few TV channels there were. And somehow the producers there had convinced somebody at one of the stations to give them enough to do 3-hour programs with what on what they call in French variété, which is popular music. But basically they could do whatever they wanted and nobody was asking them what it was. And so I was extremely lucky because the French producer Muriel Rosé, I sort of discovered Ryuichi Sakamoto at a screening of Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence in Cannes, and she had been there. So when we came out of the film, she said, you know, if you can find some way to reach him, maybe we can find some budget to produce a film, because that's the way it works. You need to have a budget, or at least then you couldn't film on your phone. This film, this is on 60mm film. So they were open to, you know, they were quite open to what I wanted to do. So there was, but the thing about making documentaries is you do have to write something on paper, usually. You know, you have to find funding somewhere. And so you have to write a description of what you want to do. So the odd thing is that in all the documentaries I've made, when you write the description, you think, am I going to really be able to make this film? Because things don't ever come out exactly the way it is on paper. But basically, that's what I wrote, you know, that it was going to be a portrait of the sounds of Tokyo and a portrait of Ryuichi Sakamoto. So that's what it is. You know what I mean?
And it's almost like precognition, though, because it becomes such a theme in his work later, is ambient noise, live noise. Also, as a subject, what was he like? Because he's one of the few kind of subjects I've seen in documentary who almost seems to enjoy being on camera. Would that be accurate?
You know, I think, you know, he is known, had the reputation for being somewhat shy. Obviously, I didn't know him, but he was, we had a very small team. And again, I can only thank Muriel Rosé from INA because these are cinematographers who are on staff, but she chose the ones who she thought I would get along with. And I had an incredible sound person who did 16mm stereo, which is a very short-lived thing. And I've hardly ever shown it in what they call 16mm stereo, but so it was a tiny team. We were 4 or 5 people, you know. And I'm not an intimidating person. So I guess that helped, you know. I mean, but definitely, it's really a feather in his cap to have agreed to do the film with me, because I had only made some short films. I showed him my photographs. And I didn't realize at the time that he was really an art person, that he was, you know, he was into art, doing happenings and things like that. When I first met him, I didn't know all that. And I learned more recently that he went back to doing happenings and things like that and more experimental stuff.
I mean, there's, sorry.
Go ahead.
He must be to some degree like conceptual. You know, there's the shot of him in front of his ads on the big screen, right? I mean, McLuhan would have loved that shot. He must have been somewhat, or was he not dictating the shots, but was that you guys?
Oh, yeah, that was us. He didn't dictate it.
I love that.
That screen, you know, if you've seen the Blade Runner movies.
Yes.
Okay, so I think, I don't know, Blade Runner, you know, they reconstruct that place, Shinjuku Squares or something, and they have that big screen. It was a time when big video screens were not everywhere, you know. It was only in Tokyo. So we rented that screen with our little budget for 45 minutes, and we put together some ads, a rock video. It was a YMO rock video, an ad for an insurance company, and we projected that on the screen. And we only had 45 minutes. And because he was so famous in Japan, they said, you know, you have to go really early in the morning, otherwise you're going to have crowd control problems, blah, blah, blah. So it was like 7 in the morning. And when we got there, after about 5 or 10 minutes, there were some groupies who came and sat down and started crying with emotion at seeing him in person. I remember that.
It's interesting because I actually have to admit I haven't heard of YMO, but their significance and their influence, now that did my research for this interview, is enormous. And that was going to be one of my questions. How did you even walk the streets of Tokyo with him, you know?
You know, we didn't really walk the streets of Tokyo. It's not, you know, the subway scene. I knew where I wanted him to get off. And we knew he could ride. He never takes the subway. That was completely faked, you know. But again, we're talking about low budget French experimental TV. So he just came into the subway 2 stops before. We were very lucky that there was an ad with him in that subway car, because I don't know if they're in every car, if they were in every car. But he was, so it was just luck. I mean, we knew he could only go 2 stops. And no, he was always in his limousine. I mean, he was very amused to come around, walk around Tokyo with us, the small amount that he did. And when we took him to... it's called Tokyo Tower, and it's the Eiffel Tower of Tokyo. When he goes up, and you go up an elevator, and you see him doing a Xerox of his hand. Okay,
yeah.
That's a big. It's like the Empire State Building of Tokyo or Eiffel Tower of Tokyo. Anyway, so again, there, I had a line producer who was supposed to be in charge of making sure there was no crowd or whatever. But again, this is a small. We have no, I mean, if you have a movie set in New York or in London or something, you have a lot of people with trucks and things. This was not the case. So what happened was we took him there, we shot a few shots, and then after maybe 20 minutes, there was a huge crowd that we had to leave.
So are there any kind of documentarians or French or even Japanese filmmakers that you kind of, that inform your style or kind of spoke to you as you made Tokyo Melody?
That's an interesting question. You know, I'm a huge fan of Godard,
I
would say. But the specific thing of making that film, I don't think I was thinking of another filmmaker. You know, at the time, Chris Marker... he had made Sans Soleil. I was, you know, I always did things on my own. You know what I mean? I've always done things sort of on my own intuition.
But it's kind of impossible to talk about what Sakamoto was doing, also because I think he was really making music for the 2000, late 90s kind of crowd. I think that he was really ahead of his time, especially when I listened to recently just his classical compositions, and they're super, very Philip Glass, very, I guess John Cage was earlier, but they're fascinating. So
Yeah, but that's what's okay. So that was very much a revelation for me, because I was born in New York, but I already was living in Paris. So I had the old world and the new world, so to speak. But I had never been to Asia when I made this film. So going to Tokyo in the 80s was a huge eye opener for me, because we're talking pre-internet, pre-world, everything. But the Japanese were aware of what was going on everywhere. You know, they were very tuned in. So when Sakamoto talks about Debussy and he knows about Asian music, he knew, he was already very world music oriented. He already knew. And so I was quite naive about that. I didn't know that, you know, because
there's a great shot where he's got this electronic computer and they're all, like they say, Nepal, Korea, Thailand, Vietnam. So he was clearly working with tons of different Asian sounds. Was that something that he spoke about?
Are you talking about when he's talking about the Fairlight?
Is that what he's got that green computer? Yeah, the one he draws on. And there's a moment where you see all his different noise samples, and they're almost all of them are different Asian countries, actually.
Right. So that's really funny to me, because then at one point I discovered that that scene with the Fairlight was also on YouTube because of certain kinds of geeks, because what you can do with the Fairlight, you can do now, I assume, in your phone or, you know, at your home computer. But at the time, it was a very expensive machine, and it was his very expensive toy that could do this with this, you know, you see him with a kind of a giant floppy disk, or I don't even know what it's called.
Yeah.
And he's explaining it, how it works to us. And yeah, he was already totally into combining all kinds of sounds from all over the world. And that amused him, you know. And again, for me, I'm not, okay, so my background, after going to art school and film school a little bit, I made record album covers in LA.
Oh, interesting. Could you mention some?
Well, Peter Frampton.
Oh, yeah.
Tim Curry, his first solo album. Do you know who Tim Curry is? Rocky Horror Show.
I know the actor Tim Curry. Frampton was the protest singer.
Actor. Okay.
Tim Curry, I know.
Actor.
Yeah.
But he made his first solo album. I did the cover. Somebody named Neil Larson, who's a jazz musician.
Neil Larson, I don't know.
Who else? But so, because I do hand painted photographs.
Okay.
And at the time, we're talking record albums, pre-CD, and pre-Photoshop. So I would get, and I would get to go to some music studios in LA, which were very high end, spend time in the music studios. So I had been around musicians and music studios, and A&M Records, it turned out, were the distributor of YMO in the United States, because they had done a US tour in the 70s. And I had records by YMO, the Japanese editions. So they had this LA, you know, they had A&M Records was a big company. I think it still exists, but who knows? They had a very good jazz label, Tommy Lipuma, who is do you know who that is?
No.
Blue Note. So I was working with different record companies in LA. And because you think it's this, you think you know the center of the world. And then again, you go to Tokyo and they're like, they know everything about everything.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny because when I saw him playing with that machine, I really thought to myself, it's not so different now. The way you make a song electronically, it really isn't.
Really? But are you a musician also?
No, I'm saying this from my limited knowledge. this is what I guess. But it's sampling, which is something that is really big now. And then kind of playing keyboards with different sounds. I assume that's what they're all doing, kind of, to a certain degree. Again, I don't know.
Yeah, no, it's true that keyboard sampling, I think, is definitely something that many people do. But I'm not the music expert. Again, I enjoy music. I'm a huge music fan, but I'm not a musician.
It'll be interesting at the screening to see kind of who came there for what. I'm sure there'll be there people there purely for his music and people there purely for his film, etc. And maybe something in between.
I have no idea. Actually, they told me it was sold out. So.
Oh, of course. I have no doubt that it's sold out. I mean, the rarities like this is what the crowds at Japan Cuts, they live for. Yeah.
I see.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you. Take care.
Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye.
So I think kind of talk about a bit more about Sakamoto and just what a kind of innovator and revolutionary figure he was. I think, I mean, for me, I think the first time I really kind of was aware of him was Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence. Mm-hmm. And particularly because I don't remember actually seeing the film for a long time. Probably my parents probably got it on video, but you know, but I do remember the version of the soundtrack that he did with David Sylvian, who appropriately enough was the lead vocalist of Japan, called Forbidden Colors. You know, and that was a big chart hit, and it was even outside of the film, that music was absolutely everywhere, and that's his kind of proper start as a film composer.
I mean, I'm the same. For me, it's exactly the same. It was Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, and that's because I was teaching film, and that was one of the films that we taught. And I think, and more so because Sakamoto acts in it as well.
Yeah,
so he's not just a composer, he also acts. So I think that's one of the reasons those things become very, very closely connected. If anybody's interested, Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence is on Arrow. So through an Arrow subscription, you can watch it for free. So I added a lot of these films that I haven't seen for years back to my kind of watch list to kind of go back to them with think about Sakamoto's processes and his legacy in mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I actually saw him as an actor before I knew he was a composer, even when I was young. And it was definitely, it was Mr. Lawrence as well was the first time I saw it. And I saw him in a couple other things after. And I was pretty young when I saw that anyway. But I didn't actually really realise he was a composer until after. And I think also for me, the thing maybe I didn't, you know, realize that so much was there's such a mad eclectic mix of films he did soundtracks for in different countries or anything like that. So even then, like, you know, when I was more into Asian cinema properly and stuff like that, even then it wasn't like, oh, here's the guy who does the soundtracks just for all these Japanese films.
So really, because he did some anime, but he did The Last Emperor, he did Sheltering Sky, you know, recently. Sorry?
High Heels, he did that film for what? So
you know, he did stuff like worked with Brian De Palma, did Snake Eyes.
That's right. I mean, that's the strangest one on there.
He right up to, you know, quite recently where he did parts of The Revenant as well. You know, I think pretty distinctively you could tell you know his work because it kind of comes back to those. Mm-hmm. That way of approaching the chord structure and the melody, I think, is very distinctive. But at the same time, doing, you know, still balancing the soundtracks with being, you know, kind of very innovative and really kind of just trying all sorts of things out in terms of how you approach music.
I think that's so interesting about him because he talks about Tarkovsky a lot in the late encoder. But when he's referring to Tarkovsky, he's talking about the sounds of Tarkovsky's films. So he's influenced by how Tarkovsky creates this kind of soundscape by using quite natural sounds. So he's kind of I mean, I think great composers are visionaries. I mean, they do kind of change things, but in a lot of ways, his understanding of sound was very filmic.
Mm. Yeah. And I think even before, I mean, you get these really, you know, some of the kind of groundbreaking tracks that you get, you know, from albums like B2 Unit, Right in Lagos, you know, stuff is just pulling from all different places and all different kind of sounds. Mm-hmm. I mean, that Right in Lagos is one of those tracks that gets sampled quite a lot in hip hop and quoted by a lot of, you know, that kind of hip hop producers. Mm. It really is, you know, to come back to what you say about this kind of cross-pollination between cultures as well, that he is, you know, you talk about Michael Jackson being adopted in Asia and being, you know, still kind of seen as this big influence, but Sakamoto, in some ways perhaps more than Kraftwerk, is actually lauded, you know, by black communities and, you know, in soul and rap and hip hop as one of these kind of great innovators as well. It's wonderfully global. It's not about, you know, it's not about any kind of race or anything. It's about the sounds and just how much there is going on in that.
And I think that's, you know, because he was an ethnomusicologist, he started not as a film composer, but he did ethno music. And I think that remains in him, this fascination with music from everywhere and this wanting to bring kind of music together in a way that's really revolutionary. Because I was only thinking about Paul Simon's work, but Paul Simon's work is, you know, yes, it's global music, but it's quite different to what Sakamoto was doing with, like, the people he worked with, the composition, the groups he worked in.
Yeah.
And that was, you know, in a way quite radical. What he was doing was quite radical at the time, you know, to see across borders and to see music as something which is universal. And I often think this about music, and I kind of try to say this, is I think there's something about music that can connect people even if you don't speak the language, in a way that film or TV can't do.
You guys know him a lot more on the sort of musical.
Yeah.
I'm not really a music guy, so all I know is kind of his the films of his where I've seen him act, and then figuring out later that he was actually the composer and stuff as well. So there's not a massive amount I could say apart from just throwing in names of other films where I can remember the music he did.
But I think that's quite important, because that kind of brings us on to Coda, doesn't it? Because in Coda, you know, when I was watching the Bertolucci again, and the way of the sound, you know, just how, I don't know, immense the sound feels. I mean, yes, I've got this lovely new TV that's got great sound system, so I felt it even more, but I felt that sense of, I don't know, kind of like infinity, if you like. I don't know kind of how to describe what he does with music, but he can make it very small and he can make it very big. And then there's a, even though he's been diagnosed with cancer and is only just getting over the cancer treatment, he goes to the Arctic and he's taking he's taking sounds from the Arctic, which then he uses in The Revenant. So I think one of the things when I was looking, and one of the ways in which the Tokyo Melody was kind of presented, and I suppose I had slight criticism of it, but I think we have to stop thinking that people are only, you know, we should only know about people when they're young. That somehow, you know, because that Sakamoto then was not at his height. I would totally disagree with that. I think that he was beginning. I think where he ended up was much more interesting than there. I think he was symptomatic. I think it was important. And I think perhaps that was more that perhaps David Barry at that particular time was that kind of icon. But I think Sakamoto you know, was somebody that never rested on his laurels, that changed and has changed music and has influenced music. And so, I mean, I learned about Sakamoto's death through the song he did on August D, Sugar BTS's album, D-Day. And so the song's called Snooze. And in the documentary that accompanies it, Sugar goes to visit Sakamoto, and that's one of the, I think that's one of the last things that was ever filmed with Sakamoto. Mm. And I think what was really interesting was this reverence that Sakamoto had for music up to the end, and also his desire to, you know, to deal with younger people, to be that role model for musicians that are coming up, to be involved in the music scene. So he never was separate to the scene. He was always part of the scene and always part of what was happening and what was going on. And I think, in a way, for me, the films, yes, are his legacy, but I think his contribution to developing musicians and his, you know, belief in musicians, to me, is probably his legacy, that is something that, I don't know if you see a lot of that kind of mentorship. So I think he was a mentor, and I think that kind of came through in the kind of D-Day documentary, and that's when I kind of learned that kind of, I think Sakamoto died before the documentary was screened. And so there's a tribute to Sakamoto on the documentary. But yeah, so I thought, you know, even then, when he was really, really ill, he took the time out to work on a track with a younger musician. And I think his humility, you know, that really comes through in Coda, that irrespective of how we might see him and of his importance, he's not really bothered with that.
My name is Frank Jen. I'm a regular contributor of audio commentaries to many Hong Kong cinema titles that are released on the UK and US boutique labels such as Eureka, 88 Films, Arrow, and Criterion. My first encounter with Ryuichi Sakamoto-san's music was through the Bertolucci film, The Last Emperor. I still remember the first time I heard that haunting opening theme, and also his use of string music really impressed me. At that time, I was already like deeply in love with classical music, even though I was only like 10 or 11 at that time. And so to hear a Japanese composer writing a soundtrack to a film in such a westernized way was really, you know, quite really astonishing for me. Then, of course, there's his soundtrack to the next Bertolucci film, The Sheltering Sky, which is probably my favorite of his film soundtracks. The main theme was such a sad, poignant yearning that illustrates the relationship between Deborah Winger and John Malkovich's characters perfectly. And this was all before high school. I befriended someone in high school who was a huge fan of Sakamoto-san. He was the one that opened my eyes and ears to Sakamoto's sound world beyond film music. That there's also YMO and David Sylvian. He introduced me to Sakamoto's solo albums like Neo Geo, Beauty, and Heartbeat, for which Sylvian contributed two tracks. And of course, through Sylvian's album Secrets of the Beehives, I got to know Forbidden Colors. At that time, I was yet to see Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence. So I haven't heard the original version of that song. So the version that Sylvian album remained my favorite rendition of Forbidden Colors. Then YMO's Multiplies and Technodelic, and the live album After Service, also became CDs that I would play almost daily during college. I liked both Multiplies and After Service so much, I would bring them to the music library I was working at University of California, Davis, where I was attending school there. I would play them along with the great Japanese jazz fusion band Cassiopeia's album. And, you know, the other students and staff would come to the desk and ask me, wow, that was so awesome. Which American band is it? And they're so shocked when I told them it's actually, you know, the Japanese composer. And then, you know, the YMO and Cassiopeia, they were Japanese bands. I still remember the shock upon hearing Paul Schaefer playing YMO on a David Letterman show one time. It was after the commercials have ended and the show's coming back on, and Paul's playing Tighten Up. And when the music stopped, even David Letterman praised Paul and said, "That was YMO, wasn't it?" And Paul just replied, "Yes, Tighten Up. I watched the Letterman show religiously, and I do not recall the show ever playing another YMO song or another Sakamoto song ever again." Of the last few albums that Sakamoto-san played or composed, Async was probably my favorite. It's like his version of a late David Sylvian album, very abstract, but also very acoustic and electronic at the same time, and fascinating from an audio point of view. I actually had a chance to hear him play Async in New York a few years ago, but regrettably, I ended up not buying a ticket, although I did eventually bought the video of the performance that was recorded there. I was surprised by how prolific Sakamoto-san was during the final few years of his life, not just by the number of albums he was releasing, but also from the 2017 documentary Coda, where it showed how Sakamoto-san would just keep on composing and arranging his new music whenever he's not too exhausted from fighting cancer. It was as if he wanted to leave as much music and his legacy as possible before his time runs out. But in the end, I always come back to his theme, To the Sheltering Sky, because it always gives me this profound sense of sadness that no matter how beautiful life is, sooner or later, it will come to an end.
I guess you could say in some ways, I mean, it's interesting to watch these, both of those documentaries kind of side by side, you know, the Coda and Tokyo Melody, and you kind of really, basically, you see him grow up, I think is what we're talking about here, because actually, I think Tokyo Melody, he's still kind of young, you know, dare I say, kind of arrogant young kind of pop star. He's aware of all this kind of information, music, and I think you can kind of see here the thought process of knowing where it's going. And actually, by the time you get to Coda, he's grown up a lot, and he realizes that he's like you say, he has this position that it's not just about me, it's about kind of helping other people. And I mean, part of that probably came out of just all that time over though. He was saying he was starting to do in Tokyo Met at the time of Tokyo Met in sort of 84, 85, but was doing more and more of this as producing other people and being that kind of, you know, falling into that mentor role and being happier. And in some ways, I feel like what's really nice about Coda is you see somebody who's actually, in a weird way, kind of more, or much, well, maybe not weird, because I think maybe a lot of us get that way, much more comfortable with themselves and who they are. Than he was in the mid-80s, you know.
And also he becomes political, and I think that's the interesting disjunction between the two. Then Tokyo Melody, he kind of says, well, I'm not really that interested in politics of it all. Yeah, and by the time you get to Coda, the Sakamoto is somebody who is incredibly political. You know, he did something in support of the efforts for the Ukrainian people, so... And he was involved in kind of environmental work. So, and I think there's a sense in which perhaps he senses the world around him and this need to kind of transform the world, you know, and you take a role in that, because a lot of older people think younger people should do all the work in terms of the environment. But he becomes intensely aware with, is it the Fukushima disaster and the effects of nuclear warfare? And the last, I mean, this is with Oppenheimer. I think what a lot of people don't get is, you know, the effects of the atomic bomb and nuclear energy is ongoing. You know, it's not something that happened once and, you know, put it to bed. And I think particularly in Japan, you know, having had two experiences of kind of nuclear, one's warfare and another one's an explosion. But, you know, that sense in which just, and I found that was when you saw all the scenes of everybody inner streets in, I presume, Tokyo, I'm not sure, against, don't open up the nuclear plants again, let's not have this energy anymore. And I think, in taking kind of leading role in that, irrespective of his health, I kind of signaled the sort of person I think he'd become. And that's why I think Coda is better. Yes, it's more of a traditional documentary in lots of ways, to be honest, whereas Tokyo Melody is not. And so I don't want to be... I think Tokyo Melody is doing something different.
Yeah, yeah.
But you learn more about Sakamoto through Coda. Yeah. And what I would suggest is that you watch them both. So watch Tokyo Melody and then watch Coda as kind of... Coda is... really quite easily available.
It's on quite a few platforms. I think there's a movie recently.
But what about Tokyo Melody? Is that available?
Well, I think the link I shared is possibly an open link. I don't know how long that link's going to go on. Now it's been restored. Because I think the interview that Yonah had with the director, it's she was quite surprised to find that it was out there on the YouTubes and Vimeos or whatever. But I think there you can find the link for Tokyo Melody. But yeah, I mean, we haven't seen the... none of us have seen the restored version of this. No. I would think that will probably make its way out as well.
I'm sure. I'd be surprised if it didn't get picked up or screened or anything.
It would be nice in kind of like a... I mean, I know the rights didn't, but in kind of like a double package or something. But that's probably a lot more complicated than it might be because it's different rights.
But you're right. I mean, it would make a great double bill because you do see his growth. And I mean, what I like about Tokyo Melody is that it is a lot of it is about him being arch and quite playful.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? In terms of a documentary and what you learn about the person, Coda is you get a lot more out of Coda in all senses.
You do, but there's more to learn, isn't there? And I can remember kind of, I'm old enough to remember the 1983s and 4s and the sort of music that we kind of danced to, the music that we listened to. So for me, it's very evocative of a certain time in my life, so I can, although, in the 1980s, besides Japan, the group that I listened to, there wasn't a lot of access to music. The great kind of thing about Sakamoto, and I kind of do want to say this, if you can go to his website, so just type it into Google, and they have got, they're kind of uploading all of Sakamoto's music and has links to everything he did, and that's been made open access. So that, in a way, is Sakamoto's legacy. So if you're interested, that's a place to go to.
I mean, that's the one thing that kind of sets Yellow Magic Orchestra and Sakamoto out from a lot of the other stuff that was coming from Japan. Because you're right, most of this didn't come to the UK, but Yellow Magic Orchestra, their first album was released in the UK and the US. I think they got a bit of a US remix. And a lot of their stuff did actually come over to a wider audience, which is partly why they became big and he became such a big star, because he was, was doing that. He was becoming quite global and quite outward facing, in world terms. But yeah, that was quite unusual. And a lot, to have that resource to actually be able to dig into his music and to be able to kind of listen to kind of B2 Unit and all that the most Thousand Knives and all those albums is
it's astonishing, because it's like the variety. So because there's also the kind of link on Twitter which I follow, and they will kind of notify you if there's new music that is available on Spotify, and it's just the music's so different that he really was experimenting with sounds and different vocalists and I kind of listened to his kind of later kind of work, but there's such a musicology to dive into. That I think, I don't know, it's very difficult when you think about like Henry Monoponi. I don't know as much about him as I know about Sakamoto. And I think for Sakamoto was kind of, was multi-talented, but that he was involved in a lot more kind of pop cultural things. And I think that, I have to say that when I found out he died, I did cry. And you never cry when people die. You know, I just don't. People die. I don't mean it like that, but, you know, it's a fact of life.
I guess it's one of those things. Some people kind of hit you a bit more than others when you hear about that sort of news. And same for me. I think Sakamoto, I mean, particularly because when Coda was released in the UK, they had a few preview screenings, and I wasn't lucky enough to get an interview with him, but I did go along to, they had a screening at the BFI and a Q&A. And then he retweeted me. So you can't really get much higher honour than being retweeted by Ryuichi Sakamoto. So, but even then, you know, I mean, he just seemed like a, but you know, but at least at that stage in his life, such a thoroughly nice guy and quite self-effacing that, I mean, that it did hit me a lot more than, you know, kind of, I mean, it's very sad, you know, all the people we've lost, you know, particularly in the last few years, but did hit me quite a lot more than most of them, I have to say.
And I think also, you know, I felt this, the only other person I felt this was when Bell Hooks died, and I think that was a couple of years ago. It's kind of people that I think have had such an impact on culture in one way or another that they still have work to do. And so not only have you lost that person, you've lost the work that they've done. That could have happened,
And now it's time for something we haven't done for a while, easternKicks picks.
It's back, and on our ongoing random, fairly infrequent-ish series. That would completely depend on how frequently or randomly things actually appear on the streamers anyway, so it's not...
Yeah, and as randomly as you can actually find them on Amazon, but let's...
Well, there is
that. What have you found for us, James?
Actually, quite a few, and on Amazon, like, shockingly, there's a couple which... appear front and center in their new, you know, newly added films, but as well, which is does not usually happen. But first up was old Project Wolf Hunting, the hyper-violent one I reviewed for the site when it was getting released in the US, which I really enjoyed. Basically, what particularly nasty criminals on a ship fighting the police and some mad hyped up zombie guy, very, very bloody, very, very graphic, kind of the Sadness-esque that kind of style. But nicely done, and definitely worth seeing. It's one of those ones I would have liked to have actually seen in the cinema if I could. It's very colourful. It's quite different to most of the Korean thrillers, which still tend to get a bit melodramatic and weepy for the last 10 minutes, whereas this doesn't. This is just, you know, all-out carnage pretty much the entire running time. So I definitely recommend seeing that for anyone who hasn't. And also Shin Masked Rider. From Japan, which I was very surprised to see, because it's currently doing the festival circuit. It's been doing it for a while, but it's still out there playing some festivals. That's directed by Hideaki Anno, our old friend from a Neon Genesis Evangelion, who did Shin Godzilla, Shin Ultraman. So it's another, I haven't seen it yet, but it's another one along those lines, looking at it, just another, it's a reboot, revisioning of an old TV show, so a bit of nostalgia in there, a bit of sci-fi action. I mean, it looks okay. I quite fancy seeing it, but it's weird with 2 hours. But, you know, I haven't seen Shin Ultraman, but Shin Godzilla, if it's like that, which was like 2 hours plus, a lot of that will be taken up with talking, which was, that was the main problem with that film. So I'm gonna take a wild guess that Shin Masked Rider is probably going to have a lot of padding as well. So I don't know. I might check it out one time, but you know, I don't know. Life's too short. On the other hand, but in terms of the older films, which you randomly find by doing things like Korean film search or Chinese film search, which just brings back mostly nonsense. I did find a few things. The Gamera films are back on there.
Okay.
They were definitely on there quite a long time ago, then disappeared and are back again. So including the three recent-ish ones.
Because they're with Arrow, so I guess they go off and on depending on whether they're on the Arrow's own
sense.
Streaming service, I presume.
That makes sense. Jiang Ke's Ash is Purest White, which is one of the few good Chinese filmmakers still making films.
Well, I think it's been a while. I mean, he did a documentary a few years back, but it's been a while since we've seen anything major.
No, he's not that frequent. There was always talk about him doing a Wuxia film, wasn't there? That used to come up in that rumor all the time. It was just wishful thinking.
It's a bit like Johnny Toe doing Election 3. It's just,
I can't really see that happening anymore, unfortunately. what else was there? The Taiwanese film Heavy Craving, which I haven't seen, but you've seen it, right?
I've seen it. I really enjoyed it. It's a really nice, it's a very nice comedy and. Very well done. Very well done. Highly recommend it. Yeah,
absolutely. So it's great. It's about dieting or something.
It's about weight loss and dieting. This person, kind of just trying to, kind of find herself. You know, it's one of those sort of films, but it's done in a way that's not. It's one of the things that everyone can watch, not just...
It's not distasteful, though, you mean? Like,
No. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. I might check that out, because I do remember quite a few other people saying they liked it. But also on the indie side, so from China, there's Mei Li and Enigma of Arrival, both of which we actually did screen at CVF, the dearly departed, much lamented Chinese visual festival. So,
were both of those with Fortissimo?
They were both with Fortissimo.
Because I don't know what's happened with Fortissimo. I haven't seen anything from Fortissimo for a while.
Not Chinese stuff. I've seen like European stuff, but I haven't. No, I haven't seen much. I haven't seen much from them. But. Then, like Fortissimo in these films, there was a few years ago, going back about 5 years, I guess, there was like one of these times where you got like a mini wave of indie films from China, which were actually pretty decent.
Yeah.
And like the guy who did Mei Li, what's his name, Zhao Zhou, he went on and did another couple of films, which played like Rotterdam or Berlin. But now, without putting mainland cinema down too much, we're certainly not in a great period for it. But this, there was quite a few films which went through Fortissimo, which we ended up screening, and it's another time where everything seemed quite promising until then it wasn't. never mind. But
I was interested to see that pop up on the old Amazon though, and
it's
kind of random.
Well, as I'll say, I'm going to talk about some genre ones, and I'll say this thing about them. I'm not going to speak to how official any of these uploads are.
True.
Put it that way. And in terms of films like Mei Li and Enigma and Arrival, you could well imagine them just being uploaded, by somebody. I'm not 100% sure, but there is a bunch of 88 film stuff, which is on the way. I assume is official because they actually start with the 88 films logos and stuff. Mm-hmm. So like I'm not going to list them all, but Dragon Lord, Young Master, Armor of God, and. I assume they're official ones. Maybe they're just not streaming on other channels at the moment. I don't know, but they seem to be the full like good quality versions anyway. There's My Young Auntie from Celestial, which is up there. You know, Lau Kar-leung directed, starring Cara Hoi. Troubled Avengers.
First breakthrough role,
that was one of her. You know, she was working with him quite often. From in the late 70s onwards, including. Clan of the White Lotus, which I was watching today for some reason.
The hard life of the commentary, man.
Yes. And, Crippled Avengers, which I think was one of the better Chang-Chi Venom Mob films. He did. I'm not 100% sure how official these ones are, but they're certainly good. They're certainly the full quality. They're not like some of the... The bizarre, god-awful pan and scan things we've seen some people uploading there. So at least there's that. But, But yeah, that's it for Amazon. So for Netflix, there's a couple of new zombie things on there at the moment. There's the Korean series Zombieverse,
which is a reality TV with Korean celebrities in.
So yeah, well, I was going to ask if you'd seen it. So is it a reality TV show, or is it like about a reality TV show with a zombie apocalypse, or is it actually a reality TV show? I couldn't tell from the trailer.
It's a scripted reality TV show. So you couldn't do a reality show with zombies, just in case somebody kind of forgets themselves and stows in the head of some poor actor.
Yeah, I don't know.
And you get into a massive legal problem. It's very much, I saw a review of it recently, and they described it as there's a BBC free series called Murder and Successful. Mm-hmm. So basically there's lots of stuff that goes on that's scripted around these people. They are sort of minor celebrities, Z-list celebrities, or maybe even a bit higher than that in Korean terms. But and then they have to react to certain situations. But it's kind of sort of slightly improvised, but scripted. So it's kind of reality-ish kind of.
It doesn't sound good. I don't know. I was hoping from the trailer, because there have been a couple of reality TV themed zombies zombie series out there.
Well, back to the old Charlie Brooker Dead Set.
Yes. That's a great one.
Yeah.
But if this is actually a reality TV show, which is semi-scripted, not for me. But never mind. Good that I know that now, anyway. But from Japan, there's a Zom 100 bucket list of the dead.
Mm.
About some downtrodden salaryman who starts to enjoy life after there's a zombie apocalypse. I mean, it looks very similar to other stuff, like the Alive, that hashtag Alive, and the Korean one and some others. Just going by the trailer, wouldn't mind seeing it, but it's not short, put it that way. So I'm going to end up saying about everything, of course. also from Japan, Paprika.
Classic.
Is on there now.
Satoshi Kon.
Yes. Yeah, which is I haven't seen that for ages, so I might give that a shot. I mean, I'm not an anime guy at all, but
I know, but his work is amazing. Different, yeah.
Yeah, he's actually good, but. Also from Japan, there's Hell Dogs, which is an undercover Yakuza crime film. Not going to watch it because it's 2 hours 20 minutes long. There's The Violence Action, which really sounds the same plot as Baby Assassins. But it's a young girl who's also an assassin. So, but I like Baby Assassins, but that was... I haven't seen its sequel, but this just sounds the same. Just going by how Netflix are pitching it anyway. Those things are a bit... You know, you can get good ones like Baby Assassins, which focus on the action, and some other ones can seem a bit noncy. I'm not sure which one this falls on, but we'll see. Then we've got The Village, which is directed by Mikihito Fuji, who also did the Yakuza film A Family for Netflix. And I think he basically just makes films for Netflix, which, fair enough. Netflix Japan, and it's some kind of dark drama mystery about a village where there's a huge waste disposal site. So it actually looks quite interesting, The Village. So I might check that out. I'm a bit more promising is Marry My Dead Body from Taiwan, which sounds like
which I've seen.
You seen it? Is it decent? I mean, it's.
I enjoyed it. I mean, it basically, for those of us of a certain age, it's basically an LGBTQ friendly Randall and Hopkirk deceased.
Okay. Fair enough. I know the show. I haven't seen it, but there was a couple of films with similar plots, very similar plots from Hong Kong. Yeah. I'm pretty sure there's a queer themed one as well, but not exactly. I guess
the most interesting thing about this is because it's only just debuted in the last few days, I think, on Netflix.
Yes,
but there's almost a rush between the New York Asian Film Festival and between Fantasia to have the screening of this before it came out on Netflix, and they're sort of rushing, it's like quick.
But my main question for you then about that is does it need to be 2 hours 10 minutes?
No.
Right.
Definitely not.
Okay, that's a shame, because it's on my Netflix list, and then when I was flicking through stuff I saw the length. I don't know. I might watch it still, but we'll see. 2 hours 10. Why? I'm not going to go off on another rant about how long why films are getting longer or just worse editing. But anyway, never mind. Finally, on Netflix, there's a Hidden Strike, the latest bizarre attempt by Jackie Chan, despite being like 70 years old, to act well, like he's didn't a,
this,
an action
this has
man.
Had a few different names, and it ran
it
and it got buried because the Western actor, old
John Cena,
yeah. Cena was referred to Taiwan in an unfortunate manner, didn't he?
He did, and then he came because he learned Mandarin and everything. He spent quite a lot of time in China. I'm not sure why, but yeah, he made a real faux pas. But then he did some groveling apology video about it as well, basically going full CCP. So,
and then it still got buried, I don't think it's really kind of surfaced until now. So, not exactly on my watch list to.
It's kind of a Schadenfreude watch, maybe just because I saw the trailer and it looks horrible. I think, you know, it's got a certain audience, which is the people who will not say a bad word about Jackie Chan or any of his films. I guess it's pitched squarely at them, and I've seen comments online, and it basically, they say they love it, good old Jackie, and then everyone else is like, nah, that's terrible. And the CGI is, even from the trailer, is absolutely appalling. So it's not very long, so it might be like a late night drunk watch, just so I can review it, because sometimes it's fun to you know how it is, sometimes you end up just watching and reviewing stuff you know you're going to enjoy, so every once in a while you have to kind of balance things out by taking one for the team and watching something, because we don't
know you're not going to enjoy unless it surprises
unless it surprises me, which I very much doubt this would, but it's that's one of the joys of streaming, I guess, is I can watch it with no effort. You know, it's not like I'd have to actually go out to the cinema and watch it. It would be a step too far, but I can easily flick it on. And if it's too painful, I can just flick it straight off again. But we'll see. It looks appalling. Anyway, finally, on Shudder, there's Contorted, which is a Korean horror film, which is not really anything about contortion at all, which really disappointed me when I actually sat down. I did watch this and I read it for the site, and I didn't pay any attention to what I was going to watch, and I thought Contortion is going to be like Yoga or one of those great old Korean horror films, and it is just another early 2000s ghost film, and it falls back on the old ghost cliches, which I don't mind, but it's trying very, very hard to be A Tale of Two Sisters. It's not, it's nowhere near as good. It's not bad though, it's visually nice. There's a bit of nostalgia from seeing the usual shenanigans, so it's, again, it's not very long and it's on Shudder, so an easy watch, but not one to run
home to watch.
And that's it. So, you know, until the next time where we actually have enough films to which have been added or which we can actually find on there, so it's not a bad haul, but that is the haul from a few months, put it that way. So
yep, cool. So that's it for now. Thanks to Colette for joining us on this episode.
For sure.
always lovely to have you on the show. Don't forget, you can find all of our previous episodes on Apple, Amazon Music, Spotify, Google, or wherever you get your podcasts. Subscribe now and you'll never miss an episode. But for now, I'd just like to say cheers. And here's one.
Cheers.
Ryuichi. Yeah. Cheers.